Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to Entrepreneur India's webinar titled India's Cryptocurrency Call. While the crypto space was mostly passive before 2020 in India, the pandemic year saw enormous interest in the space. As a result, the government has also got interested, and we are awaiting a bill that will decide the future of digital currencies in India. The space has already seen some ups and downs, and when the Reserve Bank of India barred financial institutions from participating in cryptos, to the Supreme Court deciding against it. As on date, an estimated $1 billion have been invested in cryptocurrencies by Indians already. So what will happen if it gets banned? What will happen to the blockchain space? And why is the government so skeptic about it? Today, we are going to try to find some of those answers. I'm Saurav Kumar, Editor Special Projects, Entrepreneur India. And I have with me today Mr. Neeraj Khandelwal, co-founder CoinDCX, Mr. Nishal Shetty, founder and CEO WazirX, and Mr. Akash Karmakar, partner with the law offices of Panag and Babu. Welcome, everyone. Before we start the discussion, I request the listeners to post questions through the comment section of Facebook or Q&A option on Zoom, and we will take up the questions post the discussion. So, Akash, let me start with you. The Minister of State for Finance, Anurag Thakur, recently said the existing laws are inadequate to deal with issues concerning them, wherein he was referring to cryptocurrencies. And as we speak, a bill is being finalized, which will be sent to the cabinet pretty soon. So can you take us through, can you tell us what exactly is the problem here? What is the government skeptic about?
So thanks for that. Just to very quickly lay out the lay of the land in terms of the regulatory landscape. As you might be aware, India had not taken any moves towards regulating crypto till 2018. And even in 2018, the first move, so to speak, from a regulator was by the RBI, when they decided that they would, in effect, cut off all forms of financing to and from cryptocurrency by virtue of a circular, which was dated April 6th, where they directed all regulated entities, including banks and financial institutions, to stop dealing in any virtual currency. Now, there are two fundamental aspects here which need regulation. The first is how India views and treats cryptocurrencies. And the second is how they view other blockchain-based products, which are effectively products which are based on the underlying technology but haven't taken on the color of a cryptocurrency. Those may be other forms of asset classes. It could be, say, a sound coin, which is essentially just the right to, say, for example, listen to a particular song. And for that matter, anything could be tokenized. So the problem which we've currently faced is that there's been no regulation which A, defines what is a cryptocurrency to contrast it from other crypto asset classes or other products which are based on blockchain. And B, we've thus far not really had any sort of policy or framework which governs how India views these particular classes of assets and or currencies. Now, interestingly enough, what we've suddenly moved towards is a move which is headed towards a complete ban. At least for now, it looks like there is an absolute ban on all forms of cryptocurrencies other than for the government-backed cryptocurrencies, which is a very unique position to take, because if we dial back to the origin of cryptocurrencies, it is ironic that this is the move that we are actually taking. Initially, cryptocurrencies were intended to actually operate outside of any government regulation, outside of the current regulated financial system. But I think we've come a long way from there. Cryptocurrencies have gained wide acceptance. We've got people like Elon Musk, Tesla, Uber backing Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies. So there is now need for regulation. But how we regulate it is the question here. And well, there are a couple of challenges in regulating it. The question now is, why is India taking the current stand that it's taking? And in what direction is policy evolving?
Okay. All right. All right, Akash. Nishal, let me come to you first. How founded or unfounded do you think these worries are, as Akash stated right now? What do you think of them?
Look, I think there's still no clarity on what the bill exactly contains, because the only thing that we've known is about a couple of lines that describe the bill. And of course, there's this whole section which says ban, private cryptocurrencies will be banned. Though from the last 1 to 2 years of development, what we can understand is that the government's biggest problem seems to be no one should build a competing currency to the China. More than anything else, that seems to be the biggest point of contention for the government. And I think as an industry, we are okay with that. In fact, I think I'm personally at least against someone creating a competing fiat currency for India. I don't think anyone except the government should do that. But the problem lies in the understanding, the basic understanding of how cryptocurrencies are classified. And I've been telling this everywhere that everyone's putting a blanket definition of a cryptocurrency, saying that every cryptocurrency is a currency. And that's where the whole issue that we are facing today in our country exists, where cryptocurrencies have these 4 major classifications which are accepted the world over, which is a crypto can be a currency, or it can be an asset, or it can be a security, or it can be a utility. The problem that is arising today is everyone who's talking negative about cryptocurrency, it simply thinks about the currency definition or the currency classification and puts this as a blanket point on everything. So I think as an industry, what we are also doing is to make sure before the bill even reaches a stage where it's going to be discussed seriously, we at least remove this misinformation that exists in our country. Once the information is clear, I don't think the government would want to ban something that can be defined as an asset or a utility or can help the stock markets tomorrow by issuing securities that can be traded anywhere in the world. So the currency part, I think as an industry, we completely agree. And there should not be anyone competing with our INR. It belongs to our country and that is what should exist. But the other classifications, I think that is where no one has spoken about it. And I think that's what we as an industry are trying to evolve and discuss more about. I think the bill coming there, I would still say it's positive. The reason being, I think about 3 or 4 months ago, we did not know if the government was even thinking of the sector. Now we at least know that the government is thinking about it. It's going in that direction. Let it be negative, positive, whatever. I think as an industry, the government will interact with us. And then we'll find a middle path where we'll make sure that the government's problems are solved while we keep this innovative sector and keep growing it like the rest of the world is doing. So it's okay. I think I'm very positive that we are at least doing this, as a nation.
Okay. Before I go to the next question, gentlemen, feel free to, jump in wherever you think you want to make a point, because I'll be asking questions one by one. So please feel free to do that. Nita, coming back to you next, there's one country where Coinbase is thinking of going for a direct listing. And here we are thinking of how to regulate and what to do with, crypto assets and crypto plus. And the other thing, which very importantly, I wanted to ask you, at least WazirX, CoinDCX, you wanted to have a dialogue with the government as a consultation before anything is decided. So were you able to do that?
Yes. Saurabh, you're right. Coinbase has recently filed for an IPO in the US. And on the other hand, we are, at least that's the word in the market, that India might ban cryptocurrencies. So according to me, the major difference is in the mindset here. The mindset of experimentation. So essentially, in the US, no one is banning cryptocurrencies because of its problems, because of the negative, it's probable, probably the cryptocurrencies might interfere with the central bank's policies, interfere with the government's functioning, but it has certain benefits. It has so many possible economic efficiencies that it can bring, right? So that kind of experimentation mindset, right, I think is something we need to bring in mainstream in India as well. So that is the key difference here. So in my opinion, we should not put a blanket ban on the cryptocurrencies. rather than that, we should have an experimentation mindset. As Nishal mentioned, that cryptocurrencies in itself, it's a vast domain. There are many types of cryptocurrencies, having utilities, having securities, having properties of currencies. So we should critically evaluate what are the cryptocurrencies meant for, what is it, how the technology can benefit us, and then take actions in a calibrated manner. Not just put a blanket ban on something new, something like a new technology. Rather than that, go deeper and evaluate. And of course, the industry, the government, the regulators, all of them have to come together and then understand the potential benefits of the technology and then take the next step forward. Otherwise, it's not going to be possible, because the government has so many different issues to cater to. The regulators are already worried about so many other things, right? The industry has good information about what the technology is, how it is evolving across the globe, how it is impacting across the globe. The industry has that kind of a knowledge already. So that we feel that the industry can certainly add value to the understanding of regulators and the government, how they see, how they perceive it, right? So that is why, as you mentioned, the right kind of the consultation, the discussions between the government and the industry is very key here to bring that kind of experimentation mindset. It's very important. So we have been able to, of course, you must have seen that a lot of talks have been going on in the media. A lot of media houses have already spoken about it. The industry is very vibrant when it comes to actively circulating the views and the perspectives on the industry. The formal channels need to be opened up, of course. And as Nishal mentioned, that this is the right step. This is the right step that the bill is going to be placed in the parliament and the discussions can be done around it. And, the formal official channels can be opened. Right now, we feel that the government needs to proactively discuss this with industry. That is still lacking. It's not up to the mark. That communication line is still not up to the mark. And, that needs to be bridged. So bill being tabled in the parliament in the current session could ignite that kind of a discussion and take the industry towards a positive direction.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I think I would like to add to what Neeraj has been saying. One important thing is, while we've heard of this whole bill and the ban, not even one, I'd say elected representative, like an MP, has really come forward and said, no, I want a ban in the country. And what we've been seeing by talking to them in whatever little form we've had in the past, they're all pro-innovation. So while this bill might be there, I believe that our parliament are also going to question that if no other country in the world has banned crypto, why is India, and what data has India found, or what idea has India come up with that we want to promote a ban instead of following what other countries are doing, which is regulations and bringing the right set of, regulatory processes to ensure that good actors can grow the companies. Like you said, Coinbase is valued at $100 billion. We don't have a $200 million company in India in this space. So what are we doing? I think we are already lagging behind. And if it's going to be a large issue for our country.
Let me jump in on that point, Nishal. So I think Neeraj has rightly pointed out that, there is a distinction between how other countries are looking at cryptocurrencies and how we're looking at cryptocurrencies. And just to touch upon a point that Nishal mentioned earlier, so I think we need to bucket crypto into two completely different categories, one which falls into the currency category. And on that point, I agree with Nishal that if you're trying to look at fiat currency, which is an equivalent of a country-sanctioned currency, that needs to be within the domain of the sovereign. You cannot have anything which competes with the rupee. So that's perfectly fine. So if the cryptocurrency bill in the current form, if you look at the draft, it seems to have a blanket ban rather than, draw out this nuanced distinction. Now, I have two things which I would like to propose going forward in terms of how policy should be molded. It's not where we are today. And I think Neeraj has been quite vocal about saying that there needs to be more consultations. The process has to be more, it has to integrate industry into the legislation and the legislative process. But on that point, I think firstly, the RBI's 2018 ban seemed to have been rolled back by the Supreme Court, because they said that you cannot go ahead and have a blanket ban by cutting off financing to cryptocurrencies and virtual currencies in India. That was again a blanket ban. Now, we seem to have had a rollback from the blanket ban by the Supreme Court's order as of last year. where the Internet and Mobile Association of India challenged the RBI order. Now, by virtue of a legislation, we seem to be again going back towards a complete ban. So what appears to be happening is that we're oscillating between a ban and having no regulation. Whereas what we need to actually do is to have a middle path where we say, you know what, we are going to try and understand the use cases of this technology as it evolves. Accept, first of all, that you cannot preempt every single use case right now, which is where the concept of a regulatory sandbox comes in. So the RBI, SEBI, IRDA all had launched their own regulatory sandboxes for various technologies to be tested within, so to speak, a sandbox where the regulator is able to understand what use cases are actually being deployed, how those would yield certain regulatory challenges, so on and so forth. We've not actually adapted that concept of a regulatory sandbox to blockchain technology. Interestingly enough, most other countries are saying, we don't understand what potential issues or hazards may arise out of the use of, say, tokens or, you know, such as a utility token, as Nischal mentioned earlier, or the use of blockchain in an entirely different use case, such as, say, for example, to trace the title to land, which is something which we've not been able to digitize over several years, but being able to move it onto blockchain technology would help that particular use case. And frankly, there are so many use cases that the regulator would not be able to preempt each at the time of drafting regulations. So the approach should be to set out broad guidelines which distinguish between currencies and other use cases, because otherwise what seems to be happening is there will be a lot of collateral damage where, you know, there are use cases which are not currencies. Those will start getting impacted by this 1-0 binary type approach to trying to ban everything which has the word crypto or can be blanket associated in some manner by this definition of cryptocurrency, crypto assets. What do you think, Nischal and Neeraj?
Yeah, so I think Saurabh, you wanted to ask something specific?
I mean, you answered that and then, yeah, so my point is that rightly, as you mentioned that, you know, there are four categories of crypto. It's not only currencies, there is asset, there is, you know, utility. And Akash is also trying to say the same thing. Then a blanket is not what will work, because what I believe, I will think that, you know, it's not, there's a technology called blockchain. What happened? I mean, if you ban something like, you know, crypto, then will that have a collateral damage, as Akash was saying, on the entire space, which is the blockchain development?
Yeah, so I think that's one of the other largest misconceptions, in fact. And we've seen, if you look at the history of the whole crypto and blockchain ecosystem, countries that start the negative start with blockchain, not crypto, or blockchain, not Bitcoin kind of a thing. And then eventually they understand. This has happened in the US also. The problem is, when you say blockchain, not crypto, what you're telling is, you are interested in technology that private companies will use, not the public, because you cannot have a public blockchain without crypto. So there's no technology in the world today that can give you a public blockchain, which means anyone on the internet can access and participate without having crypto to secure that network. So crypto is what secures a public blockchain. And if you're talking about a blockchain without crypto, what you're saying is it's a private company database. And as a nation, I don't see why we should be backing or promoting a private company database. We should be looking at public projects, which can only be built with crypto to secure these public databases or public blockchain networks. So this is one of the largest misconceptions. I don't know where it's coming from, but it's really coming from the wrong places, where our nation is talking about private blockchains today, and they're terming the public blockchains as private. So it's really confusing. And you know, when we go deeper, I think eventually, I've seen this narrative globally in countries, eventually they understand that a public blockchain cannot exist without crypto. So you need crypto. Because many times they say, keep the crypto aside, use blockchain. Now, if I want to build a public project, I cannot do it technically without crypto to secure that network. So this is something that, you know, the first stages of understanding blockchain where people get into. But eventually they realize it's like, you know, it's like the internet and the intranet. That's the best example. When you say blockchain without crypto, you're talking intranet. And when you say blockchain with crypto, you're talking the internet. As a nation, we have progressed not because of the intranet, but because of the internet. So if we want to innovate and progress, we'll have to adopt blockchain and crypto together. They're both sides of the same coin. And this distinction is very, very important.
Neeraj? Neeraj?
Yes, sir.
So, Yeah, so, you know, Akash made a point that, you know, there is, you know, either we are looking at binary one or zero, and we're not looking at in between, you know, either we are oscillating between ban or, you know, completely no regulation. So obviously we need to find a middle path for there. You know, I'll move to another question that, you know, say in case, there is something called, you know, if the bill says that we will not allow, you know, cryptocurrencies to operate, then what happens to the $1 billion that has already been invested by retail investors, people like you, your investors? What happens to them?
That's a very so Saurabh, it's very unlikely scenario in my opinion, but
I'm sure.
But of course, if I push my imagination, then it would be a complicated scenario, frankly speaking. You know, it would. I mean, this $1 billion is the hard money of so many people, of millions of people at the end of the day. And so the question is, if everybody wants to sell their crypto assets, who will buy it within India, right? Who would want to, especially if you put a ban, then what kind of people would want to buy crypto assets when the government is saying that you cannot, if you know there is a ban, then it would be a very difficult scenario. The prices could come crashing in the Indian market, right? And somehow essentially these crypto assets need to be sold in the international markets. Because there, of course, there is a certain degree of acceptance. India as a country will need to sell all the crypto assets held by its nationals to some other country. That arrangement needs to be made in that scenario. You cannot just ban it and say, okay, do whatever you want, sell it to anywhere, throw it. Of course, that is something which is not feasible. This money is real money. These, you know, money parked in these crypto assets, it's real money. It needs to be sold if you want to get out of it. So if the government plans to ban it, put a blanket ban, then the government will also need to make provisions to sell the crypto, all the crypto held by Indian nationals to some other country or to some, you know, foreign parties, and then collect the US dollars, which you get from selling, and then give that to the Indian. I mean, that will have to be done if you plan to ban it. And then, of course, at that point in time, government may also realize that, okay, we invested $1 billion, but now that we are selling it in international market, we are getting $4 billion because crypto has grown 4 times in the last 2 years. Right, so it would be a profit for the country as a whole.
So Neeraj, if I can just chip in there, I think the government's taking a very interesting view on this, and there could be three outcomes. The first is that and the reason for this, the compelling the sale of cryptos, could very well be because the government feels that this is actually in violation of the Foreign Exchange Management Act. And now I'm speaking purely in relation to what's happened with cryptocurrency investors in India and retail investors in India. So when in 2018, the RBI had actually banned cryptocurrencies, there was panic selling by the investors. So that results in a distressed asset sale where you really don't have much bargaining power. You feel pressed against the wall to sell at whatever price that you're selling it at. And you know, there have been investors who, yes, invested early and they may have had a 4x, 5x yield. But there are also investors who've just begun investing because the Supreme Court overturned the RBI's ban very recently. And they may be in hot water. Now, with the cross-border trade of any sort of crypto assets, there is a broader question which is currently unanswered. And that is another lacuna in Indian law, which is that the Foreign Exchange Management Act views crypto assets as a capital account transaction. Because at the risk of oversimplification, it affects your assets and liabilities, right? Now, with capital account transactions, the thumb rule is that unless it's specifically permitted, it's prohibited. And with current account transactions, it's unless it's specifically prohibited, it's permitted. Now, because we're looking at a capital account transaction and we've never really permitted cryptocurrency investments out of India, the government does have and could very well say that we view this as a violation of the Foreign Exchange Management Act.
So I think
impose a penalty of 3x on the earnings or the amount invested.
Step in out here. The RBI in an RTI query said that crypto does not come under FEMA. So this was a RTI, you know, reply by the RBI itself.
Right.
And even in the court case in the Supreme Court also, this has been again mentioned that crypto assets don't come under FEMA right now.
Well, hitherto, it's not been regulated, but given the fact that the RBI has the ability and has, in fact, in the past by precedent, retrospectively applied FEMA to certain use cases, I would not be surprised if there is a situation where there is a retrospective applicability by virtue of a circular or an amendment saying that, you know, we've not really thought about this in the past and we've had a very laissez-faire approach, but now we want to apply this sort of a rule. The danger is not that, you know, we've not regulated it thus far. The danger is that someone within the system might think that there might be a retrospective applicability. And that really presses retail investors into a hard to get out of position, because you then have to pay compounding on the amounts that you kind of yielded out of these investments. There is also the pressure of whether you declare it or not. Now, that actually is another question, which is, what happens if you ban cryptocurrencies? You're effectively pushing it underground. You're not allowing the whole point of regulation to have the benefit in the industry. Some time ago, the Financial Action Task Force had said that a complete ban on crypto, pushing it underground, will indeed result in the checks and measures such as we've got KYC, we've got anti-money laundering checks, all of those to fall away, because you're pushing it underground, you're taking it out of the scope of regulation. What are your thoughts on that? Because I believe, and I have a very firm view on this, that a ban will have a very direct impact of pushing the industry underground, because people will not want to try and lose all of the money, and that leaves them with very few options.
We've seen this happen. Also, you know, the thing is, we don't even have to guess what will happen. We've seen this happen, for example, in Argentina and now recently in Nigeria, in China, where the governments have tried to suppress crypto. And that has directly given rise to a black market and an underground economy where the government has no insights or no understanding of what's happening in the country. But there's a large premium being applied on Bitcoin. So Bitcoin prices seem to first, as soon as there's a ban in a country, Bitcoin prices shoot up because of the underground demand. And when the Bitcoin prices shoot up, when there's a large premium, what happens is your regular people who hold crypto and cannot now transact in the regular economy are tend to get pushed into this. That's also one of the reasons why the premium goes up. That's to push the common people into their underground economy, because now you get double or triple the regular rate. So, you know, when you see a 50% premium, you're pushed into that underground economy where there's no KYC, there are no AML policies. People are basically indirectly, we are going to put people at risk, because today in the whole exchange space, there's a KYC. You are not transacting with anyone anonymous. But the moment you push into the underground economy, it's completely anonymous. And all the fears that governments have actually come true after a ban. So, it's already visible and, we can learn from other countries that have tried to suppress crypto, where the Bitcoin premium seems to shoot up to 50%, 70%, pushing the regular population into the underground economy.
Very interesting thought. And, talking about that, tracing of the movement of cryptocurrency, how difficult or easy is that, Mr. Neeraj, anyone can say? I mean, some people say that, what if terrorism is funded through these cryptocurrencies? So what do we do in that situation? What would be the answer? Yeah,
the thing is, because of the decentralized nature of, let's say, Bitcoin, you cannot stop a person from sending Bitcoin to someone else, because you don't need a third party. That's the innovation of Bitcoin. It's peer-to-peer. I can send it to you without a third party involved. So you, unless you come and specifically tell me not to do it, I can do it. You can do it. Anyone can do it. The problem is to fund illegal activities and terrorism and all. Ultimately, they have to do something in the real world with that, which is where they'll have to convert it into cash. And the way to convert into cash is either using exchanges like us, where there is KYC, or using the underground economy. Now we come back to again the same discussion. If the underground economy has liquidity, then sure, you can do it. And when does liquidity come is when you erase the good ecosystem. But if you ensure a clean ecosystem, the underground economy never has liquidity. So these large amounts of money we think about in Bitcoin can never be encashed, which means they can never be used in that country. So till it is virtual, it's no use for someone who wants to use it for some nefarious activities in a country. The use case comes only when they can convert to cash. And that's the point at which governments all around the world are saying we'll catch them at that point when they try to convert it into cash to use for whatever activities they do. So this again, you know, we come back to these, if these activities are happening, you're going to aid it by banning the good ecosystem. You're not going to suppress it. You're going to in fact help them by pushing liquidity into that underground economy.
Okay. So, you know, as we go along, we'll take some of the questions that are also coming to us. So, you know, there's a question which Jayesh has asked is that what will be your next move if government ban crypto? Because one, the bill is passed and law has been made, you cannot even fight against it. I think we have more or less answered this. Neeraj has answered this question, but, you know, and he made it sound so difficult to even understand the things that have to be done. It rather be we'll make it simpler. But Akash, what do you think will be the, you know, legal recourse for people like you know, individuals who have invested money, or for Nischal or for Neeraj, or for investors who have believed in Nischal and Neeraj, then they can build a good ecosystem in the country?
So that's actually a really interesting question, and I think that there's no one answer to that. So let me try and split my answer into a couple of sub points. The first is, a retail investor really has no option but to follow the law, because as Nischal rightly pointed out, the place where there seems to be regulatory intervention is the cash to coin or cash to crypto interface, which is when you're investing or you're exiting crypto and your money is coming into or going out of a bank account, which is within the regulated financial system. So if the bill, which is currently just a draft, is passed in the way it is currently envisaged and is promulgated without any changes, you would then have to actually challenge the law based on various other grounds which are technical. And I think that's more of a discussion that we can leave for another time. But I think if there is stakeholder engagement before the law is passed, there would be clear carve-outs for retail investors. There would be a clear scheme, perhaps an amnesty scheme. And assuming that the amnesty scheme allows for people who've invested in crypto to exit, then that would allow an exit which is not under duress, which is not from a position of vulnerability where, you know, every person is undergoing a distressed asset sale scenario, which we discussed earlier. So if the law is passed in the current form, I think there are three lacunae in it, which would essentially give rise to challenges, just to very quickly give you a quick flavor of it. One is that this law doesn't seem to contemplate what happens from the foreign exchange standpoint. India has always been an exchange-controlled economy. So we need to try and figure out what is the rationale behind a complete ban, and whether the balance of convenience, so to speak, is in favor of a complete ban, which then puts to prejudice thousands, if not millions, of investors, or if it should have been a more regulated approach. I would not be surprised to see a challenge again before the Supreme Court of India if we do this, because principally speaking, we had the RBI ban cryptocurrency by virtue of cutting off the flow of funds to and from crypto in 2018. The Supreme Court reversed that in 2020. Now we seem to have a law which again overturns the tenets of the Supreme Court order. I would believe that if this legislation puts in a blanket ban, it will be challenged, and there's no option which people will have other than to challenge it. One can hope that what ends up happening is that between now and the time that there is the legislation passed, there's a consultation process, even if people have to self-declare, or if there's a requirement where people have to go through some sort of verification, that would give the legitimacy that Neeraj and Nischal have been suggesting, to say that, you know, you prevent people from getting pushed underground. In fact, even the Financial Action Task Force has said that if you're trying to combat the financing of terrorism, you'd rather take a regulation-based approach than a ban-based approach, because you're still then ensuring that people are comfortable with the checks and measures that you impose, rather than to push them underground and leave them no option but to choose this unregulated mode of exchange.
Okay. All right. Now we'll have to wait and see that in what form and shape does the bill come in, and hope the interest of everyone is taken care of. Neeraj, I'll come to you with a different question, you know, of the regulatory ones are there, but you know, let's talk about the fundamentals of a currency. You know, if we talk about it in any asset, you know, any type of this. So if a currency like a Indian rupee or a US dollar, you know, we look at economy, the GDP, you know, and that decides the exchange rate, and then the money moves in and moves up or down. You know, very recently we saw that a couple of tweets from a from Elon Musk, and you know, there was so much so much of movement in the prices. So you know what I mean? What are the fundamentals of these currencies? So say as a steady investor, even if I want to do it, but you know, if it is so sensitive to someone saying something, buying $1.5 billion of Bitcoin, and it moves up, you know, to 2-3 lakh rupees in Indian terms of whatever, I think it moved up from 38 lakh to 42 lakh or something. So what's the fundamental? How do I be rest assured that, you know, if I'm investing in something, it's not gonna be affected by unnecessary tweets or unnecessary events like these?
I think the way to look, it might seem like a tweet by Elon Musk, but you know what we should understand is if Elon Musk could have tweeted about gold and it wouldn't move, because that tweet is not news. The moment he tweeted about Bitcoin, that became news. And every media in every part of the world, not just in one country, not just in one state or city of US or anywhere else, but every media outlet, including our India media, everyone tweeted or spoke about it. So what did this happen? This gave a massive free advertisement to Bitcoin and the idea of cryptocurrency. So what you're talking about is what happens when you run a global advertisement campaign, all organically, which has never been done. This scale of advertisement has never happened for any other asset class in modern times. That's the reason why it moved, and it moved by what, 10%, 15%. So then we have to see, it's a very amazing thing. It's not a tweet that has moved it. It's the entire world's media, which is together with their own news, effected change here. And the other thing is, why is it news? It is because more and more people are now getting to know about crypto. It's still about 100 million people in the world own cryptocurrencies or know about it. And that's still a very small. So there's a large number of people who are yet to come to Bitcoin or any other crypto. And when they come in large numbers at a short period of time, you will see this volatility. So crypto has always shown us short-term fluctuations. They're wild because the market is still trying to understand what's the price out here. It's a new asset class. The market is still trying to price it. As against a gold, which is there for hundreds of years, has a large market cap of $12 trillion versus crypto, which is about $1 trillion. So when the entire world talks about it in a 24-hour or a 48-hour period, I think a 10 to 15% fluctuation is like a expected outcome. So if you're a smart investor, the moment that happens, you should understand that, you know, this is going to go viral. A lot of new people are going to come in. Maybe I should get in at the right time.
Fair enough. Neeraj, I'll come to you with a separate question because Nishil has already answered this one. So, you know, there are many cryptocurrencies across the world. If I look at them, and already we have seen scams and Ponzi schemes and all this happening. Obviously, there are bad players. But there are coins which are being, I can see on CoinDCX, I can see on WazirX. But if I look at their back history, it's not that bright. You know, we hear inside stories where, you know, the prices are pushed artificially, and the basics of how their mind are not very solid, or unscrupulous methods are used or something. So how do you ensure that whatever coins that are available on your platform are the ones which are genuine? And how do, in like, as a layman, I do not understand, but I want to enter, I would believe you. So how do I go about it?
Right. So yes, you're right. There are more than 10,000 cryptocurrencies. Bitcoin is one of them. And since it's public, it's a public blockchain concept. You know, Ethereum, there is Ethereum blockchain, there is Polkadot blockchain, there is Bitcoin blockchain. All these are public blockchain and can be used by anyone. And anyone can create a token on that, right? As long as people are able to trust the creators of the token, people can invest into the tokens and the currencies. So that's why it's a free world, and anybody can create an N number of tokens, and anybody can invest into those tokens. So yes,
We have seen a couple of bad players in the industry. We have seen Ponzi schemes being run in the industry. That, of course, that's why, you know, regulations are very important. That's why the regulations are very important, to set the boundaries of what can be done and what cannot be done. Because of, in every industry, there are bad players. You see insider trading in stock markets also. You see market manipulation in stock markets as well, in gold markets as well. But then there are regulators to control these activities. There are regulators who set the rules, who set the rules of the game, and what you can do, what you cannot do, do's and don'ts, and then there are penalties, etc. And that's how the bad actors are kept at bay from the markets. It's the same situation in the cryptocurrency world as well. As soon as regulators jump in and they say, okay, this can be done, this cannot be done, these are the these are the criteria which exchanges need to follow when they list cryptocurrencies on their platforms. Then that will automatically remove these bad players and the bad malpractices from the industry. So we as an exchange, we follow. Before that, CoinDCX Go has roughly 12 to 13 tokens only, which we have listed and which we have decided at our end that we'll promote only 13 tokens in for the masses. So we have, of course, there are very elaborate criteria. First of all, we see the history of the tokens, if they have been manipulated before. We see the market capitalization of the tokens. If the market cap is big enough, so that small money cannot just change the prices overnight. And then we see the teams behind the projects. What kind of team? What are their intentions? What is their vision behind the project? What is the utility use case of the token? Why is this token being created? Is it just a Ponzi scheme, or is there an actual real world use case, actual real world utility of the token, right? And then we see the adoption of the token across the globe. How many exchanges has this token been listed on? What governments across the globe already recognize these tokens in one way, in one form or the other? So there are so many criteria. And keeping all these in mind, giving them scores, we have decided that we'll only promote these 13 tokens as of now. And as and when the Indian government regulates it, right, gives us further guidelines on what factors they need to consider, just like they have done for stocks, what kind of companies can release their stocks in the public. It's very strict, stringent guidelines there, right? So as soon as government comes with those kind of guidelines, we would be very happy to implement, take that into account and be compliant.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Nishal, I'll come to you with the same question and also add on one more thing that, in like some of the questions that I've been told, is that, when I go through, say, a WazirX or a CoinDCX, the key of the crypto is not with the investor, but it's rather with the platform. So, how dangerous is that, or is it okay? It's fine. You hold it for us, and then you can release it anytime.
Sure. See, I think Neeraj touched upon the whole listing aspect, and it's more or less something that throughout the industry and throughout the world, exchanges follow. Certain criteria and guidelines, but if you look at it, in the crypto ecosystem, we're more or less it's like saying you have to list 30-40 websites on your exchange. Which website is going to be more useful, better, or which website is going to shut down tomorrow? It's very hard to say. Versus let's say the traditional markets, where you have a history and a balance sheet, and these companies have already gone big before they go IPO. So it's a very different dynamic that we as an industry cater to, which is we are on the innovation side, which is why there might be more mistakes done compared to traditional markets. But I definitely believe that with the right regulatory processes and approaches, we can reduce them. But you can't escape it. I always tell them that, always one of the factors we do is look at the team behind these products or projects. And we also listen to our users. Many times we don't want to list, but our users want it. And we get hundreds and thousands of requests saying list this because we want to be involved. So then you have to listen to the community. So that's the other thing. Now coming to the whole key aspect, the private keys. The thing is, there are two things that you can do with the Bitcoin. I'll just consider Bitcoin out here. You can either custody it on your own, which is called self-custody, or you could have a third party safely custody it for you, which is custodian. Now, as an exchange, we are custodian, which means we hold the cryptocurrency that belongs to you. But that does not mean you cannot hold it yourself. All you have to do is you have to withdraw it out of the exchange and to your own personal crypto wallet, where you will hold the key to it. So it's a choice. You want to keep it with yourself. The benefits are you hold it. No one else has access to it. The bad thing is, what if you lose your private key? There is no way anyone in the world can help you recover. So that's the choice you have to make. And with a custodian like us, we make sure we custody it and we keep it safe. But there's always a risk. You've seen of prior risks of some exchanges losing, getting hacked. So that risk exists. The way to mitigate this is to make sure that you see how long the exchange has been, what are the safety measures they follow. So look at the history of the exchanges and then go. Many times what happens is fly-by-night operators, they just want to give you a good price, but they don't have the checks and stuff behind the scene to secure your assets. In such cases, maybe securing it on your own is better. So it's a matter of choice, but the best thing is to have a choice.
But Nishal, like say in a stock exchange, I have so many brokerages tracking it and I have it listed and everything. I know it, but in cryptos, if there are so many currencies and which shows day by day 5%, 6% increase, I as a layman may not know the team behind it, or I may not know the actual story behind it. So isn't that somewhere a responsibility of an exchange also kicks in?
So see, the thing is, that's what I said. If you do not want to go deep into this, the best thing is Bitcoin. It's something that everyone understands. It's an asset. It's been proven over 10 years. So just use that. Everything else is really high risk. And that's for sure. And only if you know and have the time to invest by understanding what it is. Because every crypto is different. If it was a blanket, it's not a currency. Like I said, utility tokens. Now, every crypto has its own utility. Now, for me, a utility might seem very stupid, but for the world, it might be amazing. So what question is, can I as an exchange decide the future of a technology, or which use case will emerge? Because if I can do that, I would rather build that on my own. So it's just really difficult for me to understand whether, because a lot of these criteria, by the way, Bitcoin would have never been listed on any exchange if exchanges said, we want to know the team behind it because the founder is anonymous. But yet today, Bitcoin is a $1 trillion ecosystem. So it's very hard for us. What we can do is just put it in front of people saying, these are the things, but now you have to do your research. That's the best way for you to invest in this sector.
Mm. Akash, would you want to add before we take some questions that we have got?
I think the comparison which Nishal is making is the only thing which I would add to, which I think might not be a perfect comparison, because the exchange essentially acts as an intermediary. Whereas with crypto exchanges, what ends up happening is that the exchange is not just an intermediary, but also a facilitator. Now, the issue here, which I think Indian regulations need to tackle, is that we need to very clearly delineate risk. In what circumstances are the exchanges liable, if at all? And what circumstances are the investors liable? If the government feels that it's a very high-risk investment, which I think everyone's very open about, even Nishal has agreed that this is high-risk meant for sophisticated investors, then the government needs to allow people to invest because they're doing it out of their own free will, much like how they'd increase the entry criteria for portfolio management from 25 lakhs to 50 and then now to a crore. You just need to have different thresholds where the investor is either sophisticated by virtue of the amount which is invested, or where the government says that these are the circumstances in which you agree to take on all of the risk. Beyond that, I think it needs to be up to the people to invest and do what they choose. Banning them to protect them from a market that they will try and access in any way is rarely ever a successful tactic to try and stop people when you've got... We have seen this across multiple use cases, and this is going to be no different. People will find a way to invest in it if you try and ban it. In fact, it just evokes more curiosity than anything else.
All right. So we have a few minutes left before we wrap up. So we'll take up some of the questions that have come in. So Shipra has a question. If you can give the mic to Shipra, and Shipra, if you can ask your question, please.
Thank you, Saurav. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are. Please go ahead.
So my question, either Nishchal or Neeraj can take it up. I want to know, this is from an investor's point of view. Apart from investing, what are the other use cases of Bitcoin, you know, that have emerged in the recent past? Because from what I can understand, from 2017, late 2017, when Bitcoin had its last run up till now, not a lot of use cases have emerged, except the point that the industry keeps saying that it has become an asset class, which is understandable. But apart from that, an investor, where else can an investor actually use the cryptocurrency that he or she is invested in? If there are not enough use cases, then do you think that the industry should proactively work towards creating those use cases? Because I'm not sure till when the selling point of it being an asset class can work for a small investor, for a retail investor.
So I'll just take a part of it, and maybe Neeraj, if you want, you can elaborate on this whole thing. But it's a good question. The thing is, if you look at Bitcoin, it's not, while we say it's an asset and it's a store of value. The biggest use case is it's a store of value. And you do not have another store of value which is globally accessible with no geographic barriers. It is the innovation of Bitcoin itself. The fact that now you have programmable store of value, which anyone anywhere in the world can access using a mobile phone and can custody it on their own, self-custody, that does not exist. So what we are asking about is, why do you want more use cases when something that was virtually not possible 10 years ago has been made possible by this innovation? And Bitcoin is the symbol and the whole crypto that started this. So the world, what they're showing with Bitcoin is, we trust this as a store of value because it's movable and I can keep it on my own. Gold, I have to carry it. You have 10 kilos of gold, either you give it to a third party where you don't know how or when you'll get access to it, or if you have to physically keep gold, that's one way. The other is you have this, which is just on your mobile phone. So now you have a programmable store of value. The use cases now will emerge once all the infrastructure that is needed is built up. Today, we are in that stage where the infrastructure is still being built up for a decentralized ecosystem. Once the infrastructure building phase is done, then we will see these use cases emerge. It's like the internet could not have actually emerged as these use cases. The early days of the internet, people said, is it all about email? Is it all about chat? But we are seeing all the use cases of the internet emerge even today. Why? Because the last 10 years, internet was laying out the foundation. Our mobile phone, your access to cheaper internet, all of these, the cables, even the laying of the cables to get internet to all parts of the world. These were the infrastructure lying, phases. And that's happening in crypto right now. The thing is, we are all experiencing it. We've not experienced these. As a generation, this is the first time we are experiencing a new financial internet being laid out. So eventually more use cases will emerge. But right now, the whole fact that there's an innovation in front of us, that itself is the reason why these valuations are. The moment more use cases rise, Bitcoin is easily going to overtake gold also. It will go over $10 trillion someday when more use cases emerge. So that's something I think we should all be aware of. And before we question it, we should look at where it is today. And it's at a very beautiful phase where we can get involved early. Later on, when the use cases come, we are already late to the party, I believe.
All right. I have two more questions. I'll quickly ask them. So one is, the government is mulling over introducing its own digital version of INR. I want to understand that such a token, will it qualify as a cryptocurrency? Because it will still be, it will not be decentralized. So in that sense, will it just be a digital version of fiat, or will it qualify as a cryptocurrency?
So, Shripra, do you mind if I take that one?
Yeah, yeah, please.
Last week, the RBI's governor, Shashikant Das, he had said that the RBI was working on some guidelines to have a central-backed digital currency, central bank-backed digital currency. So these central bank-backed digital currencies actually are a departure from the original concept of how cryptocurrencies were envisaged, because they were intended to be decentralized. Everybody would have a common ledger where they would be able to transfer the currency from person to person. Each person was able to validate that transaction. And it was intended not to have any sort of hub and spoke model. Now in this new, the central bank-backed digital currency model, what appears to happen is that it's a hybrid model. So it's essentially a digital currency with a central validator, which is the bank. And I think that there is no way of looking at this other than to consider it to be a quasi cryptocurrency insofar as because it's a fiat currency equivalent, right? You have to have the central bank back and issue those particular coins or tokens. So insofar as, yes, it is based on the blockchain technology. It is a representation of stored value, and the value is fixed at whatever it is in terms of however you peg it to the rupee. But that's where the similarities end with the blockchain. So this is actually going to be a relatively unique concept because of the manner in which it's going to play out. With any sovereign currency, I think, you know, there's no divorcing the role of the central bank.
Yeah, but, you know, India should definitely build its own CBDC, own digital INR, because the advantages of having that is immense from the settlement time. If you see today, banks, the settlement period between banks is huge. The moment you get a digital INR, you have instant settlement. So all these cases of, you know, your money getting stuck in between two banks for 5 days before they say we'll reconcile and give you the money back, that will just disappear. And, you know, the settlements will be instant between banks. So I think we should definitely build that as a nation.
Okay, yeah.
I would also like to answer or address both of your questions. The first one was about further use cases apart from as an asset class. So for that, I have just one very small point. We have so many different cryptocurrencies having different use cases in the world. Payment is one thing, you know, utilities, smart contracts, it's smart contract based, logics built on top of cryptocurrencies. That is there. While for the Bitcoin, I think there is no further use case required as such. Being a asset class, being a store, which has superior properties like portability, so all that. And globally, people are already trusting it as an asset class. So I think that's a good enough proposition for Bitcoin itself. Secondly, the second question was about, pardon me with your second question, please.
The digital currency.
Yes, so central bank's digital currency. So in my opinion, on the one hand, Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies were born out of complete, the concept of freedom, like no government control at all. Completely free from the rules of the government, right? And on the other hand, we have the fiat currencies, which are completely controlled by the government, 100% controlled by the government. The rules of the game are fully built and created by the government. These are two extremes. I think the transition would have a CBDC in between, where it's a mix of both. Some properties of a decentralized free world, some properties of the controlled currency regime, and that's what CBDCs represent. You cannot go from a completely controlled currency system to a completely independent and non-controlled currency system. There has to be something in between, and that is what I think CBDCs represent.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. Just one last question. This is an industry question. I was reading about, in one of the news reports, I was reading about this association that has been formed by crypto entrepreneurs, which is known as Association for Blockchain and Crypto and Digital Asset, Asset Entrepreneurs, the short form of which is ABCE. So I want to know if either WazirX or CoinDCX is part of it, And if it is, then in what way is this association, trying to lobby, with the government to kind of stave off the likely ban?
See, I think it's still early to talk about the whole association. Right now, we are all part of IMAI, and there's a subcommittee under that BACC, and we are all part of that. Whether we'll build a new separate one or not, I think over time we'll all decide. But right now, as an industry, we're all under this BACC, which is under IMAI. And on our end, what we are doing is, look, we are trying to meet as many regulators, MPs, whoever is involved. And as an industry, and also we are trying to tell all our customers and people in crypto that write to your MPs on why you believe India should regulate and not ban crypto. Because when we as a nation, there are over 10 million people in India who hold a cryptocurrency. And people get surprised when they hear that, because they think maybe a few thousand people are involved. There are over 10 million, that's over a crore Indians. So when all of us tell our leaders that, why we should regulate and not ban, our leaders will listen to it. So as an industry, we are doing this at the grassroots level. It's not going to be about one or two companies getting together and solving this for our nation. All of us have to do this together. And so one of the biggest thing we're doing is that rallying and telling everyone in the country, tell what you believe. If people of India want a ban, sure. But I believe that maximum people who understand this technology do not want a ban. They want regulation. They are not looking for anonymity. They're looking for participation. And I think that's what, as an industry, we're driving the most. Rallying our people to tell their respective MPs on what they expect from the government. If we don't speak, the government will never know. So that is the biggest thing that we're doing as an industry right now.
All right, thank you.
Okay, we have run out of time, but we have a couple of interesting questions. So I'll just read them out and, we'll. So there is a question from Kuldeep. He says that suppose government doesn't ban crypto assets, but allow only the institutions to trade or deal with it, just like Hong Kong has recently proposed. How will that impact exchange and crypto cryptocurrency retail market, Neeraj?
Yeah, so that's a plausible scenario and good to start. Right, it might, government may believe that we do not want to expose the whole country to a volatile asset class, but rather selectively just have experts who are investment experts first experiment, and then probably at a later point in time go for the complete public access. In terms of exchanges, of course we'll have to. So the effect might be completely different. We, of course, our products are to be geared for a retail person, etc. On the other end, institutions need different kind of services, different kind of KYCs, different kinds of trading instruments. Right? So,
I think, while Neeraj is trying to somehow fit things into what will happen, I think it's a very elitist approach to even think about, only allowing companies and not the people of India to participate. And I think as a nation, we should not even, be okay with this, where we allow companies to deal with something so that later, I think the people of India should be involved in this. I don't think it's a company's domain and companies should be allowed and we are not. I don't think that line of thought should even exist in our country. But I think,
And that won't be even democratic, right, Akash?
Yeah.
If someone is selectively given, and they gain,
make
the gains, and then we are allowed the time, retail investors can't even buy a small piece of it.
No, sir. Unfortunately, Saurabh, I'm going to have to disagree with you on that one. So it would be democratic because there's a concept called intelligible differentia. So when you're able to intelligently differentiate between two nuanced classes of people because of sophistication, for example, there's an investor, say, who wants to invest in a portfolio management scheme, or they want to invest in an alternative investment fund. We don't allow people to invest less than a crore in an alternative investment fund today because we believe that people who have a crore inherently have the level of sophistication. So one may say, why do you have such barriers to entry based on monetary thresholds? Whatever those barriers are, and I can see Nishal shaking his head in disagreement, saying this is rubbish. But those criteria of how we distinguish a sophisticated versus an unsophisticated investor will have to be determined. So I think the caveat emptor rule has to be adopted in this industry, because truly, if the buyer is not aware of the risks, you should not be investing in it. So if the government says that, you know, you've got to have reams of disclaimers that are signed off by the buyer, I'm sure neither Nishchal nor Neeraj would actually shy away from that.
The reason why I'm laughing is, even to prove intelligence, the simplest is years of experience, and most companies in India wouldn't have the experience of an individual in India who's been into crypto. There are people in India, individuals who've been into crypto for 5 to 7 years. So even if we look at the intelligence level, I think the people of India are more intelligent than the corporates today in crypto. I can't say about the traditional markets, but about crypto, I think every individual, a 22 to 25 year old will beat teams of corporate, 10 people by just sheer experience or in the speed. So I think I'm not laughing about the money part, but I think intelligence, it'll be the people of India who will win. It will not be corporate out here.
I think that leads us to the point of saying the question which really needs to be determined here is, how do we determine who is sophisticated enough and who has the risk appetite to invest in cryptocurrency, and delineate those from the retail investors who are merely lured by saying, okay, this looks like it's got a great return. Because I think the only intent of regulation, and I think the legislative intent has always been, whether it be the RBI or it be SEBI, to try and protect the gullible small-time investor from investing in something that offers very high returns but offers risk which they are not able to appreciate or which is beyond their appetite.
Okay. I think we have really run out of time, so we'll have to finish it here. But thank you, everyone. Thank you, Akash. Thank you, Nishchal and Neeraj, for joining us today. And it's good to hear views from of all sides, because what I believe is a healthy dialogue, a discussion, can only lead to a robust, ecosystem of crypto. The entire, as you said, there are not only currencies, there are other things and there are other benefits also. And I hope that, you know, all this discussion, not only here, but across the nation and with other stakeholders, will lead to a place where we actually could see something which promises to be the future possibly. So thank you, everyone. And thank you to the attendees.